Hi, Pamela Geller from the fabulous blog Atlas Shrugs, here at an undisclosed location in New York City. And we are with the man, the legend, Geert, who is a member of Parliament and has his own party, Freedom Party.
Yes, Party for Freedom.
Party for Freedom, so American.
Yeah, it is.
How'd you get away from us? And we wanted to talk to you about why you came to America, what are you doing here in America, and what you hope to accomplish.
Yes. Well, I come here to America, to my American friends. It's always a pleasure to be here, to talk about the threat of the Islamization of our societies. It's also happening in the United States, but unfortunately it's even worse in Europe, that the influx of the Islamic culture, the Islamic ideology, is really that strong that we are not only losing our identity, but we are also losing everything that we stand for when it comes to freedom of speech, when it comes to the rights of women, of homosexuals, whatever. And what I wanted to say to the American audience today here in New York is that they should be aware that America, even though America has its own problems, could be the last man standing, because Europe, if not already lost, is almost lost to this terrible fascist ideology called Islam. And well, I hope to get some support for that view.
Oh, I intend to help you get some support.
Thank you.
But you, when you mention America alone, it's much the way Mark Stein had described it in his book, which was a seminal work.
It was a very, very impressive book.
Impressive book. And I do see parallels between what happened on your continent and what's happening here. We're not as far along. But the pattern and everything, the actions, are most disturbingly similar.
Yes. Well, they are similar. I remember when I arrived yesterday morning, afternoon, in Washington Airport, and I didn't believe my eyes. There was a very big sign, a picture actually, of, I believe, three Muslim women in headscarves, and a huge mosque on the background that said, "Welcome to the United States." And I thought, This is not Europe, this is the United States. What is happening here? It was not there the last time 1 year ago when I visited the United States. But you are fully correct, both in the United States, but like I said, even more in Europe. The political elite and the press, I mean, they are together a bunch often of leftish liberals, are closing their eyes for the problem that the real people, the people who have to pay the bill, who pay their taxes, who have to walk through the streets and bring their children to school, what they experience every day. And this is that they don't feel comfortable anymore in their own country. They feel as if they have lost their own country. If you live today in many neighborhoods of Amsterdam or Rotterdam or any other city, Marseille, Cologne, whatever place in Europe, you will feel often that you are in some Arab country. And not only because of the numbers, we have 55 million Muslims in Europe today, only 1 million even 1 million in the Netherlands. But it's not only the numbers that concern me, it's also the fact that those people, I call them colonists, are not coming to our continent to assimilate and to contribute, but many of them, of course not all of them, but many of them are coming here not to assimilate, but to submit us.
Yes.
And this is because, the reason is of course that Islam is not a religion of peace. Islam is an ideology of hatred. The Quran is a fascist book. Muhammad was not a very nice man, but was a war criminal, a pedophile. He did things that he today would be executed for if he would have lived in the United States. And people who are worshipping this kind of dangerous ideology are pampered by us. We are, I always say, the biggest disease in Europe, and perhaps also in the United States today, is the disease called multiculturalism, a cultural relativism. People who believe out of a false context of political correctness that all cultures are equal. But like the brave American psychiatrist from the Middle East originally, Mrs. Wafa Sultan, said, and I respect her a lot, and she's fully right, and said that it's not a clash between civilizations, it's a clash between rationality and barbarism. And this is what we really should acknowledge, that Islam is not another leaf on the tree besides Christianity and Judaism and Hinduism, that Islam will never accept anything else than to rule and to treat anybody else as dhimmis. And unfortunately, we are, at least the political elite, is acting as dhimmis, is looking in the other direction. And I think that we should become stronger, be more proud of our identity, and start a fight against the influx of the Islamization, because it will kill our freedom, it will kill our democracy, it will kill everything that we stand for. We could not have been sitting here today in this restaurant as we are sitting today if Islam would get its way in the United States of America.
I couldn't agree with you more. I find it unnerving that the media, power without accountability, refuses to report the news and what is happening. And if you do, look, in America, it was shocking. I'm sure even to those in Europe that we wouldn't print the Danish cartoons, those innocuous cartoons. When I went down to a speaking panel, they refused to show the cartoons. They were easels with black cloth on them. But you see, and then it makes it all the more sinister and mysterious. The Americans haven't a clue. Yeah. And when Islam does come up, you have groups, unindicted co-conspirators, whose original leadership was Hamas. They're speaking for Islam. They're suing people on a plane that said, hey, these guys, they're screaming jihad, I'm very uncomfortable. Those people got sued. Yeah. Now, but we have a thing in America, if you see something, say something. But look, you say something and you get sued?
So you cannot say anything anymore.
Exactly.
So even now you see that they are working against, working for the demolition of the freedom of speech in America today.
Right.
Maybe not by laws making them preventing it happening, you have your First Amendment, but by afterwards suing you so that you people are afraid of saying their mind. And instead of a government acting against it and the government defending the right of the people, they are looking in the other direction, and the press is also ignoring the fact. That is why it's so important that people like yourself with your fantastic weblog, but also other people like myself and many more who make a short movie, who make presentations.
Make a short movie. I just want to say something. The short movie that he's referring to is Fitna. It's on my blog on the right bar. It is a most exceptional film. And it's an exceptional film because there's no opining in there.
No.
It is purely fact. Surahs, hadiths, and the actions that are taken as a result of these surahs and hadiths, and it was a simple, brilliant masterwork.
Well, thank you very much, and I tried to do my best to not using actors, but to show the audience, and I'm very happy that tens of millions of people saw it already within 2 weeks after it was put on the internet, that, to show what existing surahs from and verses from the Quran, and use real-time images and see and to show the people that indeed the Quran is not a book from 1500 years ago. It's a book that is still very alive today, and it's not a book of peace. It's a book of war, a book of submission,
yes.
A book of terror, and such a film. It would be impossible to make such a film today about Christianity or Judaism. And when it comes to Islam, those are not incidents. It's a structural problem, and I hoped with my film Fitna to open the eyes and to educate a lot of people in a tough way, but in a way that is needed, to show them what the real identity of Islam is. And don't let them fool you by so-called moderate Muslims, who at the end of the day, if you are familiar with the word taqiyya, if Islam would get its way, if Islam would become more dominant, it wouldn't even have to be 51% of the country. Look at countries where the numbers of Muslims are 10, 15, 20, 25%. Entire societies will change. And people who say today that they want to assimilate will change by 180 degrees, and they will follow the Islamic ideology of hatred and violence. And this is something indeed that we should do anything to prevent it happening.
Well, it seems there was a recent poll in the UK,
yeah.
And the result was that 40% of the Muslims polled wanted Sharia.
Yes. Well, they got their way, because last week parts of the Sharia were implemented in the United Kingdom. I mean, who would have imagined that a European country like the United Kingdom would implement Sharia? We even had a minister, an attorney general in the Netherlands, who said a few years ago already, that if he could understand that the Sharia would also be implemented in the Netherlands, if the moustache yourself before, there are thousands of chamberlains in the European and perhaps even US politics. People who appease, who give in, who give up, who give away our identity. And what people need is not only to hear the truth about Islam, but they need politicians who are honest, who are transparent, who fight for the preservation of our cultural identity, who fight for our freedom in the short term and in the long run. And this is totally lacking today. So I hope both in the United States as in Europe that more politicians stand up, tell the truth and fight like Mr. Tancredo does with his perfect initiative in the United States.
It was the Jihad Prevention Act.
Yes.
Now, I don't know how well it's going to take off because he's a maverick. But thank God for mavericks, because without mavericks, we'd all be done.
Sure.
And he was, of course, he was pointing to the results of that poll that you and I had just discussed. And he wants to send a clear message that the only law we recognize here in the U.S. is the Constitution.
Exactly.
And he wants to deport anybody that believes in Sharia or wants to bring Sharia to America. And the thing about America is, it's not an ethnicity. America is a shared value system. That's what we are. That's why anybody from anywhere can come and be American. And that sort of breeds an American exceptionalism. But I really feel that the American people are being deceived, enormously deceived. And it's dawah. It's like when Hamas says, okay, we'll have a ceasefire. Ceasefire translation is hudna, which means, hudna means regroup, rearm, get ready for the next fight.
Yes. It is a dawah, indeed. And
Israel experiences it a quarterly.
Yes, and this is also what I'm going to say at my speech today here in New York, that the fight from the Muslim terrorists, the Palestinians or the jihadi, against Israel is in fact not a fight against Israel, it's a fight against us. Israel is taking the blows and the first and the attacks that are not only meant for Israel, but are meant for the West, for the entire West. And it's a very big misunderstanding to believe that it's a territorial conflict. It has nothing to do with territory, it has to do with ideology. And God forbid it ever happens. We will do everything to prevent it. But if Israel once would really cease to exist and the Muslims would get their territory, it's not the end of the process,
it's the beginning
of the jihad. So we should also be more close and more supportive about of Israel and fight their fight against the terroristic attack, because once again they are not aimed at Israel, but they are aimed at all of us.
Now, do you see any movement in that direction, Geert? I mean, looking at Europe, and I see an enormous amount of anti-Israel, anti-Jewish strains there. My question to you is, how is it trending?
Well, it's very double. You are very right. If you speak out, like I do, in favor of the United States and in favor for Israel, it will only cost you votes. But still, politicians need to have principles and speak out anyway. But there is, at the same time, you see in the Netherlands, for instance, there was a recent poll by a historical monthly magazine, very respected, and it showed that 60% of the Dutch, 58% actually, of the Dutch electorate thought that Islam was the bigger threat to their society today. And that 56% of the electorate believed that the mass immigration policy from Muslim countries was the biggest mistake of the Dutch government since the Second World War. So my point exactly is, and you see it with also parties like mine growing, seen as maverick parties maybe, but growing in all of Europe. Some more serious, others unfortunately more to the xenophobic or racist side that I do not and will never subscribe to. The problem is that there is an enormous gap between the political elite and the vox populi, the voice of the common people. And I'm more positive every day. I mean, I have a new political party. We started 1.5 year ago for the first time in Parliament with 5% of the vote.
Wow.
Today, 1.5 year later, we have 10% of the vote.
Wow.
We doubled for a new party. And there are more parties in Europe like that. So I think, and this is also the greatness of the summit in Jerusalem at the end of the year, where I hope you will be present yourself as well.
I shall be.
You should. And that there are lawmakers coming from all respected European countries, democratic lawmakers, who try to make an effort to combine the forces, come with initiatives, and show the people that it's not only one or two mavericks in every individual country, but that there's a real serious political force who takes the people in Europe and in the United States serious, who are against Islamization, who are not racist, who are not xenophobes, but just people who are proud of their identity and believe that our country should never be Islamic, and that we should get rid of the worst kind of Islamic culture and values.
I must say that we all have to be very creative in trying to reach the hoi polloi, as it were,
yeah.
Because the media is working against us. You created a film, Fitna, which I think is an exceptional film, a brilliant film, from the music down to the illustrations, but you did not opine.
No.
You used surahs and hadiths from the Quran, and you tied it into things that actually happened as a result of those surahs and hadiths. And you got a very visceral response, and it was a beautiful film.
Thank you very much.
We were moved to tears. I have to tell you, in my apartment, just a cute little aside, there were men doing work, and they're entranced by what I do every day. So when your film came out, I ran home because the text came in, it's out, it's gone,
really?
Before I take it down. So we all ran home, and I put it on, and I'm like, shut up. And 40 men, you know,
really?
Burly men, with the things, stood silent, and they watched. I have to tell you, it was like something to see, mesmerized. And then after it was over, the guy goes, we got to do something about this shit, you know.
Well,
but they had no clue.
Okay. But this is where it's very good to hear. And if this is the effect of Fitna or of your great work with your blog, this is exactly what we should do more.
Yes.
We should more educate, more get the common people who feel that there is something wrong, but are either afraid to speak out because it's politically incorrect or because they are being sued if they do.
It's a form of
litigation. To make it normal and common to use the most important right that we all do have, and that is our freedom of speech. And never accept that through appeasement or through leftish liberal press persons that people are not willing to speak out their mind. And you are helping them, I hope I am helping them, and if we do it more often every day of our life, I think this is the mission that we share, then people will see that they are not idiots, but they are normal people, want to live a normal life. And if they would have wanted another life, they would have moved to Saudi Arabia or Iran. They didn't. United States is not Saudi Arabia. Europe is not an Iran. Let's keep it at that.
Do you think that Ahmadinejad should have been allowed to come here with all of the taxpayer dollars at work to protect him and all the cops? And he's up on the podium and he's talking about the Zionist criminals and they're applauding him.
No, Ahmadinejad is indeed, he's a war criminal.
He's a war criminal.
He's a war criminal, and he should be treated as such. He should be brought to the International Court of Justice in my country, in The Hague, and be sent to prison for the rest of his life. He's only not threatening Israel and other countries to bomb them with the most terrible, in the most terrible way, but he's also, when it comes to his own countrymen, he's doing the most terrible things. He's ignoring all the... He is the example in the Middle East of a politician that should not be taken seriously. And the more he is invited, and maybe formally he has the right to go to the UN and speak, and I don't know about that, but if I would have anything to say in US politics, I would have not granted him to come to the US soil, and if he would have done it, I would have arrested him on the spot and sent him to jail for the rest of his life.
Bravo. And one last thing, what do you think of Obama saying he would meet him without preconditions?
Well, I think this is, let me be very careful this way because it's internal American politics, but no, let's be honest. I think Obama is, in that way, I'm only talking about wanting to meet him, acting as a kind of Chamberlain in the end of the 30s in Europe, who wanted to talk with the Nazis. Really, I'm not exaggerating. The president of Iran is the same or even worse than the Nazis was, and you should not want to meet a Nazi or the Iranian president. So I think what Obama did there was very irresponsible.
Very irresponsible. But we have to, there has to be more of a transatlantic movement, don't you think?
I surely do.
I mean, all of us that are fighting for freedom, we all have this create some kind of a model, a loose model, but we're all working together, and so all of our efforts can be pooled together because the sum is greater than the parts.
It's true. So this is why, once again, I invite you to come